Here's my script. All right, here we go. You, Short Box Nation, welcome back to the podcast. How are you doing today? And I sincerely ask that this week. If you are a comic fan that's been keeping up with the news this week, I kind of got an idea of how you're feeling, but I want to know, man. Hopefully you guys are feeling better. Hopefully you guys are feeling great and ready for another excellent episode. To all of our new friends joining us for the first time, my name is Botter. Welcome to the Short Box Podcast, the comic review and talk show where you hear the best conversations about comic books and other forms of pop culture that they inspire. It is my honor to welcome you to episode 374. It's just me and Ed today, so you'll have the usual... So I'll save you the usual extravagant and cheeky introductions that I like to do. It's just a two-man show today. What up, Ed?
What's up, man?
I'm tired. It's been a busy week. I just like from the emotional, you know.
And we had the hurricane, context. Too.
Damn, that's right. We also hurricane.
What a week.
Did it become a hurricane? Or was it a tropical
storm? Late.
Oh, yeah, very
it
late
surged.
In the game.
It did a surge.
Much like its positioning in the month. Very fucking late in the year. It's like, come on. Come on, Florida. Yeah, it's been a busy week. So, listeners, I'll save you the cheeky introductions because we've got some business to get around to. We got a lot to talk about. I'm going to let my man John Stewart punctuate that.
We've got things to talk about.
Today, we'll be taking a departure from our normal comic spotlights to catch up with the latest comic news and pop culture headlines. Unfortunately, this week hasn't been filled with a lot of happy headlines. So I'll let you know now, I'll give you a forewarning that we're going to spend a lot of time paying our respect and celebrating the careers of three comic icons and legendary artists that left this mortal world way too soon. You know, and we're going to do our best to keep it, you know, hopeful and, you know, a celebratory thing. All right. Mm-hmm. It's already been a lot of somberness this week. We're bringing some positive energy to this episode today. That's how I'm going to approach it. Now, I encourage you to check out the timestamps listed in the show notes below, since we will be talking about such a variety of topics. Maybe there's one that piques your interest particular. Maybe you want to skip one. That's all good. If you want to hear a specific time or a specific topic, check out the timestamps in this episode's show notes. And if you're looking for our in-depth Black Panther Wakanda Forever review, that is exclusively available on our Patreon. All right. That is for our Patreon community exclusively for the time being. So if you want to hear that, So if you want to hear what we thought about the movie, or if the weekly episodes just aren't enough for you, if you're someone that's like, yo, one episode a month, an hour and a half of the Short Box crew is not enough, please consider joining our Patreon community for access to a ton of bonus shows, as well as the monthly spinoff podcast, Pilot's License. You'll also get episode voting privileges when you join the community. I'm telling you right now, the rewards and perks that you get for the modest $2, $5 a month, so basically the price of a fucking regular comic book in today's day and age, or the price of a Snickers bar. the amount that, you know, the small amount that we charge for membership is a small thing to pay. And, you know, for some of you, that's like chump change, you know, for some of you. All right. But for us, hell, I'll take them $2 a month. All right. We'd really appreciate the support. It'll help us keep the lights on. And it would mean a lot to us. Right. So join our Patreon and level up your Short Box listening experience by smashing the link in the show notes, or you can just go to patreon.com/shortbox. And Ed, I've actually got some good news, man.
Oh, we need it.
Speaking of Patreon, I'd like to make a big deal in welcoming our newest members. Members being plural, right? We got two new people that joined the Patreon today. So let's go ahead and bring the trumpets for them. I want to go ahead and welcome and congratulate two people on joining our Patreon community and thus making maybe the smartest decision, financial decision of their lives, or at least for the year 2022. All right. I want to go ahead and give a round of applause and welcome Zach Armour and Guido of the Dear Watchers podcast to our Patreon community. That's right, man. We got our homeboy, Zach, joining the show. You know, he went ahead and made the jump to the Patreon and newest member Guido, who I just met today. I recorded a podcast with the Dear Watchers podcast. They are a weekly comic book podcast hosted by Guido and Robert. And every week they explore a different multiverse, from Marvel's What If to DC Elseworlds and far beyond. I told them that I thought their concept for a podcast was brilliant. And I wish I would have stolen that years ago. But Guido became a fucking Patreon subscriber right after we done recording. I didn't even bring out the Patreon.
That was your fee, though, right? Oh. All right, dude. You got to be level.
Yeah, that's funny.
This is about,
I'm like,
look, cut this out.
I'm like, yeah, I'm like, you want me on a podcast for 2 hours? All right, I need you to be a Patreon subscriber at the $5 tier.
At least 6 month commitment.
It caught me by complete surprise.
Nice.
I didn't bring up the Patreon. I mean, they asked me about, you know, the short box and all that. But yeah, pleasant surprise that another comic podcast decided to support the show. Wow. And I told them, from one podcaster to another who understands like what it means to put yourself out there and ask people for support and money, it meant a lot to me. So big shout outs to Zach and Guido for becoming the newest members of our Patreon. They're about to be living it up big time.
That's right.
They're gonna fucking be able to vote on episodes. They get the shows early. They get bonus stuff. Like, all you short box normies, man, you guys got still waiting on you guys to see the light. But all good. All right. With the sales pitch out of the way, like I said, we're going to keep this intro short and sweet. We're just going to get started on working through some of the topics that we have today. Ed, let's go ahead and rip the Band-Aid off so we can get cheery and celebrate some awesome comic creators. Yes. How do you want to kick us off this week?
I guess we can start with the passing of Kevin O'Neill, longtime Alan Moore collaborator. He is one of those guys, when I think of British comics, it's him, Pat Mills, Simon Bisley. Those are the three guys. And like I said, you can see they're kind of cross influences each other. And like I said, he's one of my favorites. I kind of got to, I guess, first became aware of him with the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
Yeah.
Which is probably one of my favorite Alan Moore titles. And jarring style. Not very polarizing, I think. It's like a Mike Mignola on a crack.
it's really scratchy and like crosshatch.
Yeah, it's scratchy and it has that flatness kind of like Mignola has, but there's so much detail. And like I said, his watercolors are really nice, but you can see the influence on, if you ever seen any of Simon Bisley's non-painted kind of interiors, like he has kind of that wild scratchy style, and Pat Mills. So you can see that kind of circle of influence. And like I said, that's 2000 AD. Those are the three guys I think of, you know, when I think of like, and that's kind of like my, I guess my first real introduction into kind of that European comic book style before seeing the, you know, like the Mobius and people like that and the heavy metal stuff. But yeah, these guys are from England, are kind of like my first exposure to comics, non-US comics or European comics, I should say.
Cool. Yeah, I'll admit that, you know, I'm maybe putting myself on blast, but Kevin O'Neill, I'm not the most familiar with his work. I've read like League of Extraordinary Gentlemen like very early on. So his passing, like, you know, I had to do kind of I had to catch up and do my homework, which was kind of like a bummer, you know, like, so being into comics this long, I think it's safe to say there's still like blind spots we all have. Especially with like names like this, where it's like, no, you should probably know who Kevin O'Neill is and his impact to like the British, you know, wave of comics and things. But
and that's the thing too. There's just so much to know about. It's like being a fan of anything like music, you know, it's like you're going to miss things. But, you know, as long as, you know, what's really cool now is like we have access to it. You know, we can like do a Google search and see thousands of images, and we can have access to his books digitally or physically. So it's a cool time to kind of go back and, you know, really learn about these people that we may have missed, you know, reading comics.
It got me thinking, you know, just not to get like deep into some rabbit hole, but it just got me thinking about like comic books and comic creators, and I guess really like just art in general, where with comic books, like, there's just one creator, one artist, one writer, whatever, one creator can have so many bodies of work. And even though, like, maybe they're no longer with us in the physical, like, these bodies of work, like, you know, can stand the test of time, can be here for generations to come. And when you think of someone like Kevin O'Neill, who's in that upper echelon, like, you know, his work will be probably talked about, examined for years to come. And so in a way, like, you know, it sucks that, you know, they've, you know, like Kevin O'Neill, Carlos Pacheco, and Kevin Conroy, like all passed this week, but the legacy and the bodies of work that they have left behind, it's like, are they really gone? You know, they're not, they're never going to leave our memories or our thoughts.
Yeah. Like I said, you have at least, you know, 40 something year career of work from 2000 AD to, he just finished, I think, a few pages unpublished that are going to be in like an Alan Moore book, like an 8-page story. So he was working till the end, and the like I said, he has a very polarizing style. I'm not going to say it's not like Alex Ross where everyone's going to like it. You know, 99% of the people are going to like it. It's very edgy and it's so awkward and bizarre that it got like, you know, the comic code said, we can't publish this Green Lantern story. It's like, what happened? Is there like a nipple or something in here? It's like, no, your drawings are just too weird. Yeah. We don't want to print this shit out. It's too weird. And it happened with martial law too. And when I think Epic Comics brought it over, that they had some issues just because his style was so crazy. And he's such a sweet looking old man.
Dude, and he's funny.
Yeah.
I was reading the New York Times wrote a obituary or a write up on his passing and his, you know, his impact. And they gave like a short kind of quick crash course on his career. But at the end of it, I guess maybe they spoke to Alan Moore or he called in or sent something in. And he was talking about like, you know, even at the, you know, ripe age of 69, he was still very funny and comical. Mm-hmm. And I guess like he's one of the very few partnerships Alan Moore has had in comics where it hasn't turned sour. Like they were still friends to the very end. But he said something like the last time he talked to Kevin was on the phone and he brought up how they have never fought or something like that. He was like, yeah, we've never really butted heads or fought. And Kevin's response was like, well, we've also never never slept together or had sex. So those are two things. Those are two things I'm really appreciative of.
Ooh.
Which was a hell of a response.
And that, yeah, there's a whole Lost Girls. You can just look that up and see what that did too. That's a reference too.
I'm glad you brought up that Green Lantern rejection story because that was, you know, a story I hadn't heard before. And I love finding like stories in comic book in the industry like that, right? That don't really, you know, that just kind of paint the person in a different light and really kind of get the point across as far as like their unique style. But for anyone that's unfamiliar that might be tuning in, Ed was referring to Tales of the Green Lantern Corps annual number 2. Kevin O'Neill did the interiors. Mm-hmm. And this was around the time, this book was released around the time the comics code was still prevalent. And, you know, DC and I think even Marvel were still sending their comics in to get approved. The book was rejected, to Ed's point, not because of, you know, maybe some grotesque, you know, subliminal sexual thing. It was just because his style was so out there.
Yeah, it's too weird. We can't print this. And that's kind of like you can see his influence on a lot of, you know, if anyone watches like Carnatuna's Kayfabe, like the Outlaw comics, you can see that kind of really rough, scratchy style. And you can see his influence on a lot of those guys. But he's like a kind of like an arts outsider artist that made it, you know, that's worked in mainstream. So like I said, he's one of my favorites because I like that kind of bizarre, you know, bizarre, very unique, very unusual, very imaginative character design. So he checks off a lot of boxes for me when I look at an artist.
I wasn't familiar with his like editorial and like industry side, like business side. I read that he was one of the, I guess he was like an editor for 2000 AD. And one of the first things he did was like successfully lobby to get credits added to the stories in 2000 AD.
How wild is that?
Dude, yeah. Well,
what's your name?
even more wild to think, Dave Gibbons, I think also was in that New York Times article, but was talking about how they would pay people or employ people to remove artist signatures.
Mm-hmm.
And their whole, I guess the reasoning was we don't want to, if we add credits, like, you know, artist credits, it removes the mystique and mystery for the reader. What the fuck?
We gotta pay them royalties and shit.
Backwards, you know, math is that.
It will ruin the kid's imagination. Like this is supposed to just come like magically appear out of nowhere.
Yeah. So that was so that's awesome that Kevin O'Neill was also, you know, fighting for artists for artist rights.
Yeah.
For so very basic artist rights.
2000 AD has a bad history of that, and it's so funny. It's like, could you imagine? It's like just getting your name on the book that you
have to lobby for.
You
it.
Gotta like.
Yeah. We need an inside.
That's
man.
Not automatic. That's how far things have come. You know.
Have you ever watched the? I was just put onto this, but there's a documentary about 2000 AD.
Not yet. No, I've seen it.
I didn't know
it's
that
on the list, but I haven't got.
It
a chance
is now
to watch
on
it.
The list for me for sure. Word. Ed, you got anything else to say about Kevin O'Neill?
No, like I said, it's if you're looking for if you like kind of something non-traditional, like I said, it's weird that we have these two artists, which are which we'll get to, but they're like the polar opposites of comic book artists. But if, like I said, I can't recommend League of Extraordinary Gentlemen enough. It's one of my favorites, and I will go to Champion Season and recommend some further, because that series actually continued past Jim Lee selling ABC and Wildstorm to DC. So okay. That had the big falling out, because that was under the America's Best Comics imprint, which was a Wildstorm imprint.
Got it.
Okay. And then, yeah, Alan Moore, yeah, he's like, I'm selling this to DC, Alan Moore. Do you guys have any beef? So,
well said. I think what I'm going to, I think to further dive into, make up for all these years, I think I'm going to check out this 2000 AD and see what they say about Kevin O'Neill. I'm sorry, I'm going to check out this 2000 AD documentary and see what they say about Kevin O'Neill. Good stuff. All right, continuing on the celebration train is what I'm calling, because we're celebrating life and accomplishments. We were unfortunately also treated to the news of Carlos Pacheco passing away this week as well. He died at the age of 60 due to ALS, which is a neurodegenerative disease. Mm-hmm. He was a Spanish-born artist. He's worked in the comic industry as early as the 90s. I know my first conscious exposure to Carlos Pacheco's comic book artwork was a Bishop limited series that my dad gave me. It came out in 94. I think he gave it to me, you know, as a kid. So like early 2000s.
That's his first series.
Oh, really?
I think so, yeah.
I will never forget these sweet Hollow covers. I thought that awesome. My dad was, my dad was really into Bishop. He loved it. He gave it to me to read. I remember being like all bent up and shit, but the artwork was awesome. So that was my first conscious exposure, was my dad giving me that book. But of course, the guy ended up touching every notable character in DC and Marvel's catalog. Like, you cannot think of any major notable character in those two companies that he probably hasn't worked on. Another iconic body of work of his that resonated with me and is honestly in like my top five, maybe top 10 favorite comics of all time was Avengers Forever. It was written by Kurt Busiek. Carlos Pacheco does the artwork for all 12 issues, and it is amazing. It's like this very complex Kang the Conqueror time travel multiverse kind of story. There is literally like 1,000 characters and different versions of the Avengers in it, and it is a hell of a sprawling kind of big cross, self-contained crossover event. But that made me an instant fan of Carlos Pacheco. The dude has style. Mm-hmm. I feel like when you look at his artwork, he's got that unique style where, you know, he's in that camp of like, you look at his artwork and you're like, oh no, I recognize him by the style. I don't even need to, it doesn't have to be a recognizable character. I just know that's Carlos Pacheco's artwork.
Draws great, like, you know, groups and action too.
Yeah.
He's a really good action artist.
Some of you eagle-eyed listeners might be familiar with the very iconic X-Men image that was kind of floating when he was on the X-Men in the 90s, but it's the one where it's Colossus holding, lifting Wolverine up with one arm, ready for like a fastball special. It's like Nightcrawler and Storm and Marrow and Kitty Pryde are all surrounding them. I think that's one of his more iconic X-Men images that you've seen in like ads and promos and shirts and et cetera, et cetera. But he was also an accomplished, you know, independent creator too, because he teamed up of Kurt Busiek on a title called Aerosmith, mm-hmm. which was a fantasy series and actually earned him an Eisner Award. I'll be honest, I haven't read the series, but I'm excited to dive in.
I flipped through like a couple issues, and it's cool because it's basically like set during World War One, but with fantasy elements in it. So it's pretty neat.
Yeah,
and that concept. Was in, yeah,
and that was
Kurt Busiek. I mean, that guy can write.
Oh no, for sure. Like one of my favorite writers of all time. And you know, it's one of my favorite artists. So I'm check that out. But that was in 2003. I mean, Carlos Pacheco, like I said, passed away at 60. He was still doing work up to like, I think he announced his retirement this September. Mm-hmm. And,
the damage control cover.
Yeah. The last thing he did was a cover for a comic series called Damage Control. So, I mean, the dude was still working up to, you know, his last couple months. The way I would describe his artwork is it's fluid. Mm-hmm. I think it's soft, but it still maintains like a realistic style to it. And there's just so much swag to his style. And there's just so much swag to his style. Like, his characters just look cool. Like when you look at like his his Superman Batman series, which is one of my favorites, called Absolute Power. He did a 5-issue series in Superman Batman in 2003, where it's like this alternate reality where Superman and Batman are kind of like authoritarian figures. Just the way he draws them, they're always like in a cool stance, you know? They exude a lot of confidence.
Yeah, it's a very clean style. Like I said, you couldn't pick two more opposite ends of the spectrum as far as comic book artists. You know, his work is very clean, very like superheroic. You know, it's like kind of, if you ask somebody off the street, oh, this guy draws, you know, this is what they think of when they think of comic arts. So, but yeah, he's got a career. He didn't fall into a lot of the weird stylistic trappings of the 90s. He survived all the weirdness that happened during then. That's kind of when he began his career.
Yeah.
So he's thrown right in the middle of probably the craziest time in comics, stylistically.
Yeah. Well said. I longevity is a word that comes to mind. As someone that started, you know, early 90s, survived that period, you know, got through 2000s, you know, the rise of Image, was able to do like independent work and, you know, still doing covers up to, you know, just last month.
Yeah, he started off just drawing like pinups and posters for, there's like, you know, places that translate Marvel comics. So he was basically doing,
I think,
you know, pinup stuff for the Spanish, the people who, the company that translated the Marvel stuff in Spanish.
Mm-hmm. And they took notice. Yeah. Which is, interesting career, amazing artist, definitely lost a very talented artist. I will say, you know, sad news, sad part of it aside, what was interesting to, well, really, what is always kind of interesting to see during these kind of like sad times is the amount of stories and respect that you see paid by other industry professionals. I think like my Twitter, you know, I follow a bunch of comic writers and artists and other professionals on Twitter, but my feed was like, has been nothing but great stories being shared all week. It's unfortunate, like the catalyst as to why they're sharing these stories, but you know, just to see the outpouring of like respect being paid to like Carlos Pacheco and Kevin O'Neill, and to see like these big companies like New York Times covering this.
And what's cool, it's like I follow Bill Sienkiewicz, and he usually does a portrait. So he did a portrait of Kevin Conroy, Carlos Pacheco, and Kevin O'Neill. So
he did one for Carlos Pacheco as well.
Yeah,
that's cool. All right, I'm gonna check that out. That's really, that must be a very tough tradition for him to upkeep. Like
colleagues too, you know.
Yeah, well said. And I guess, you know, it feels weird saying last but not least, but you know, the final gut punch is what I'll say, that we got, I believe Friday, right? Friday.
I think so. Yeah, Thursday or Friday.
Thursday, Friday, or late. Last week was the news that the Batman himself, is what I'll say, left the physical realm. Kevin Conroy died at age 66 after a battle with cancer. The news was announced by one of his colleagues, Diane Pershing, who voiced Poison Ivy. She had kind of broke the news, and from there it was like it was a hell of a time on Twitter. I could definitely tell this one. You know, this one definitely hurt a lot of people. Now, because it wasn't just like diehard comic fans like ourselves that have a lot of respect for like Kevin O'Neill and Carlos Pacheco, but like TV, movie, you know, actors, TV fans, you know, writers. It was Kevin Conroy's passing was like a moment.
It's one of those things when it's in like other, like in animation or video games, so many more people will hear his voice than would read a Batman comic.
Well said.
You know, so he's.
Yeah.
I mean, this generation, everybody thinks of Batman. They think of his voice. If anyone else does his voice in any like game or cartoon, it's like, who's this guy?
You know? It's like, even though you've never met Kevin Conroy, his voice is like ingrained in a lot of people's heads. You know, I know I've seen it, you know, shared plenty of times already. Me and C were talking about it. I was talking about it with some other friends too, but it's like, to this day, I'll read a Batman comic book, and that's his voice. That is the voice. My default voice is Kevin Conroy. It's never been like Christian Bale or, you know, any other. That's a good point.
You imagine like.
That's a good point.
Is that in your head?
Yeah, that's a very harsh reason. Very good point. For good reason. You're right. Kevin Conroy, default Batman voice, I think, for anyone that's a Batman fan. Mark Hamill shared some awesome words. You know, he was a colleague and basically the other side of the coin when it came to the animated series. He voiced Joker, but Mark Hamill said He was one of my, he said, quote, he was one of my favorite people on the planet, and I loved him like a brother. He truly cared for the people around him. His decency shone through everything he did. Every time I saw him or spoke with him, my spirits were elevated, end quote. And I think that's just a sentiment that I've seen shared about Kevin Conroy.
Yeah, and it's such a funny way that how kind of life works out, because this guy's like a Juilliard actor, Juilliard-trained, you know, stage actor. And he basically, I was reading an interview where he just went on this just on a hunch, just like, I'll go try it out, why not? And didn't read Batman comics, just knew the Adam West Batman, and got the gig. And he, now that's what pretty much, that's kind of defined his career.
Wow. You know? Dude, yeah, it's crazy to hear those stories of just like absolute kind of like caution to the wind, kind of like, let's just, like,
why not?
Why not?
What do I got to lose?
And you end up becoming the fucking definitive Batman for everyone in the entire world.
Like a 30-year career?
What? Dude, 1992 is when he started voicing Batman. That's insane. Yeah. And I was looking at his credits, and it's like, if there's any word, if Batman is in the title of anything, his name's kind of attached. Some of the credits include, of course, the new Batman Adventures, Batman Beyond, Static Shock, Justice League Unlimited, Batman the Brave and the Bold, Tales of Metropolis, so on, and even some of the short, you know, animated films.
He's like, the voice in the Arkham Knight games too, right? Is he, or is it someone else?
I'd have to double check, but I think he is. I think it's safe to say. I'm pretty sure it is. But Justice League versus the Fatal Five, and even the Scooby, even Scooby-Doo and the Guess Who. Yeah, I think the only good news that I can kind of remotely grasp and you know, upside to this is, one, the fact that everyone is sharing their favorite memories of him. Two, everyone is sharing, like, you know, recommending and sharing their favorite Batman episodes. Mm-hmm. So that's given me, like, you know, a reason to dive back into the series. But also, his final Batman credit is listed on IMDb as the upcoming TV series Batman Caped Crusader, which is currently being filmed. That was the show that is, that's got Paul Dini.
That's right.
Ed Brubaker is involved, and some other names as well. I for some reason I thought that fell through, but I guess it's still being filmed.
I remember
filmed.
Talking about that. That was a while ago. Yeah.
Yeah. He said Kevin Conroy apparently voices Thomas Wayne in the show, and it's slated for like a 2023 premiere. So that'll be, I'm looking forward to that, to say the very least.
Yeah, and it's just like, just one last thing on him is, and like, of thinking about like my favorite line or favorite episode, it's like my favorite thing about is just when he changes from Bruce Wayne to Batman.
Oh, man.
Like the shift in voice and tone. It's like, that's so brilliant. It's something you, at least I never thought of, like with alter egos, like how do they change their voice? You know, Superman still sound like, you know, Clark Kent. Do they modulate their voice in a way?
Yeah.
And it's just so perfect.
It's as it's as impactful to me as watching like Christopher Reeves do the you know, change from Superman to Clark Kent on screen, you know, like watching his mannerisms. And you know, I'm not a voice actor or an actor at all, so I can't really speak to the difficulties of both, but I would imagine it's maybe a more unique challenge to do that with just your voice, you know. You can't rely on body
characters
motion.
But they have to be the same character at the same time,
just through your voice. Awesome. We lost a hell of a talent. All right, moving on to maybe some lighter news, some good news, especially for fans of the DC universe movies and TV. A few weeks, maybe a week or two old on this announcement, but I thought I'd spotlight it, and that is that James Gunn and movie producer Peter Safran, who is of Annabelle, The Nun, and Aquaman fame. I think he was a movie producer on those films, among others, are sharing CEO duties of DC Studios. Like I said, that was announced maybe a week or two ago to much fanfare. I mean, a lot of positive reception to it. I think it came shortly after the premiere of the Black Adam movie.
Yeah.
So say what you will about that that timing. I know the former, I don't know if it was the former CEO, because I think this is like a brand new role for the companies that have a CEO.
And it's like
DC
a split
Studios.
CEO. Yeah.
Yeah.
One, I think James Gunn is handling the creative side, and the other guy, he's doing like the more business production side of things. So it's makes sense.
So for the, and I guess it's a 4-year kind of contract at first. Gunn is in charge of the creative side of the DC Studios, and Safran, like you said, will handle the business side. Gunn will still direct films, which is, I think, is the cherry on top.
Yeah.
It's like, not only is he overseeing it from like a Kevin Feige type role, but he's also getting his hands dirty. There was something that happened this week where I guess on, you know, with this news, I think there's a lot of hopeful DCU fans, and there was like some hashtags going around like Save Legends of Tomorrow, that CW show, as well as we see this hashtag resurface a few times, but release the Ayers cut of Suicide Cut, of Suicide Squad. His response was, which I think is cool, that James Gunn has this thing of like being rather active and vocal on social media. I think that's pretty cool that he's able to kind of like be with the times, and you know, he's reachable, I guess.
Yeah.
But he responded to the hashtags and you know, people wanting that, and basically saying like, yo, I really appreciate it. You know, we hear you guys. And our goal, he says that he wanted everyone to know that his team and the regime will be focusing on the stories going forward, as well as attempting to tell the biggest stories ever told across multiple films, TV, and animated projects, which was kind of like a nice way of saying, like, yo, look, them dreams ain't happening. We focusing on the next.
My Suicide chapter. Squad's the only one that matters. And you can just let that die. That ain't happening. Yeah, it's very diplomatic.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's kind of like a very nice no. You're a nice guy. We could still be friends, though, right? You know?
Yeah. I'll share this other quote, you guys. As the new and first ever, so like I said, I guess a brand new role they made for Gunn and Safran. As the new and first ever CEOs of DC Studios, Peter and I think it's important that we acknowledge you, the fans, and let you know we hear from you, we hear your different desires for the pathway towards for DC, which, let's be real, that is something that I don't think DC fans have felt these past couple of years. Like, they've been heard or, you know, listened to. Maybe the Snyder Cut is an exemption to that. But, this is a good look, man. James Gunn, to me, is someone that has a vision, that is able to execute. He looks like that's someone that respects the source material, that finds ways to, like, really focus on character development. Yeah,
he's got the track record for his Guardians movies.
Well said.
He still's got another one coming out.
He is someone that's able to bounce between both camps, and no one gives a fuck. They're like, nah, we want some of that gun magic over here. We'll share. Like, he is the one thing that DC and Marvel are willing to share. They're like, nah, you get a little bit of that, too. Ed, my question for you on this topic is, what's a DC property that you want to see Gunn and his team and this new regime tackle and bring into the DCU?
Oh, man. I would kind of like to see, let me try to think what the name of it is. I wouldn't mind seeing like some more offbeat, off the wall type characters, which I think is his specialty.
Mm-hmm.
Like maybe like something like the Outsiders or like the Authority, something different, something that's not Batman. Like I say all the time, let's chill on Batman for a minute. But yeah, even like I said, even, I don't know, maybe New Gods. Anything Kirby DC related, I'm down for. And I think they're strange enough and he can handle those type of quirky characters like he has a track record of.
I'm surprised you haven't said Lobo yet.
Ooh, Lobo.
Because Jason Momoa was on, was it Jimmy Fallon, I think, or one of these late night shows, and they asked him about James Gunn, and he was like pretty excited about maybe, I guess he brought up the idea of like playing Lobo, which I think Jason Momoa would play a pretty cool Lobo.
Lobo and, I guess he could do double duty.
I mean, he kind of talks like Lobo already. He kind of has like that inflection in that
needs
voice.
To work out more, though, and needs to get that white. It'll probably be a CGI character. But yeah, Lobo, I don't know how I missed that. But yeah, anything different, anything kind of new, and like it's kind of get away from the, even from the JLA properties for a while. Just kind of do some new, interesting things with characters that deserve more, you know, recognition, you know, mainstream recognition.
I'm trying to think of the name of that. Was it Villains United from DC Comics? I'm trying to think where it had like Catman. Yeah, Villains United. Okay. Mm. Do you remember the series? It was like 2005 series. It had like, it was just focused on a supervillain team. It was like Deathstroke. Catman is in it. It was like two opposing, the six. Does it show it? Damn. You know what I'm talking about, though? Villains United, Catman. Oh, okay. It was called the Yeah, Villains United, and it had Secret Society of Supervillains. No. Oh, the Secrets. Okay. The Secret Six is what it's called.
Secret Six. Okay. Yeah,
okay. I would love to see him do the Secret Six, which is a 2005 story by Gail Simone. Gail Simone and Dale Eagleshim did the artwork, and it focused on villains like Catman, Deathstroke is in it. Ragdoll was in it. Like a bunch of just like B-list kind of C-list like character. Yeah, Deadshot, Catman, Ragdoll, Black Alice, Amanda Waller. It was basically like Suicide Squad.
Black Alice. For the most part. Oh man,
I just want to see him do like villains, and especially with his knack for like violence. After watching Suicide Squad, I think he would also probably do a really good direct a really good Injustice movie too.
Mm.
Based on like the video game story and bring that to life. I think he would excel at something like violent, a little with a little dash of raunchy.
Yeah. Cuz
he could really make it all about the characters like he did on Suicide Squad.
Okay.
If that's anything to run with.
Yeah, and then like I said, that's kind of like about the Authority, cuz it's kind of like a raunchier group, and or maybe even he can convince Guillermo del Toro to go back and do that Justice League Dark movie.
Yeah. Good stuff. All right. I guess on the topic of movies and cinematic adaptations of comic books, your topic that you brought to the table kind of, it kind of exemplifies that.
Yeah. AMC, they announced this, I think, originally in March, saying they're getting to the comic book publishing business. Because I guess, their biggest thing has been The Walking Dead. So I guess they're wanting to keep more of that stuff in house. Go ahead.
Real quick, Walking Dead immediately came to mind. I was like, nah, AMC has way more properties than just Walking Dead. So I went on their website, and Preacher was among there. Of course, like Better Call Saul. Mm-hmm. I mean, Breaking Bad, I think, was also AMC one. Comic Book Men.
Yeah.
But there was so many Walking Dead variants. I did not know there was this many spinoff shows. There's like a one about like the Navy, like a Navy, like underwater Walking Dead. Yeah, with so many of them.
Walking Dead goes to Hawaii. It's like the police
basically
academy.
It was a lot of Walking Dead spinoff shows I had no idea existed.
Zombies in Paradise, The Walking Dead. Yeah, they released the press statement, and like I said, when they did it in March, it was just like they just blurted a few names that, but no real artists or any creative themes. They said, oh yeah, we got Stephen King doing something maybe, and it was just very like, all right, whatever. But
someone text Stephen King. Text Stephen.
Someone tweet him. But they released they had a press release saying, AMC Network's publishing adds a new comic series to its fan focused original titles. Kelly Sue DeConnick and Bill Sienkiewicz, they're doing a title called Parisian White, and basically they're give a little bit of a premise of the book, which I read it 8 or 9 times, still no idea what this is about.
Same.
About paint and like it's one what paint it, is poison it, and weapons and yeah, seems
it,
very
it
artsy.
Almost sounded super artsy.
It was like, oh,
super
boy.
Artsy.
This is gonna be pretty to look at.
It was it was almost read like paint is almost like in human form or like some shit like that. Like it actually is
like
a
paint
lot.
Is taken from this parasite in South America.
Yeah.
What? All right.
Very heady concept.
It'll look nice. But and like I said, Kelly Sue DeConnick has, she's a good writer. We'll see. It's those are two big names in the comic book field to get. And then they mentioned a couple other titles. They had like Kirk Hammett is writing a book for Metallica. All right. It seems very random.
Dude, someone just went through the Rolodex. You can imagine like an exec at AMC has got like a super tight Rolodex.
His phone number. You want to do a comic? Who wants to do a comic? Kurt, looking at you, buddy.
Imagine an AMC exec sending a group chat to like all his like famous friends. Anyone want to do a comic in here? Don't worry if you've done one before.
Yeah, the title's called Knights of Lono, and it's a I want to say it's a, I don't know. I didn't write it down. But there's another Oboulette and Tula Latte from Wicked and Divine is attached to that. And Brendan Fletcher, who's a best New York Best Times bestseller and the comic book writer as well. So they have some, they're getting some names, and it's just interesting that, you know, they are, you know, going in on the publishing game too, rather than like what they've done before was getting the licenses like for Preacher and for Walking Dead and all its spinoffs. So it's interesting that it's like, okay, let's kind of keep this in house. Let's develop our own IPs.
I almost read it. And that makes sense when you consider like what IPs they really, I mean, we made fun of it in the beginning, but they have way more than just Walking Dead.
Yeah.
And when I was going through the list, I was like, I guess this could be made into a comic book. So Ed, my question to you is, of the many AMC properties, like what is one that you think would make sense as a comic book outside of like Walking Dead?
Yeah, well, if we're looking at the AMC umbrella, mm-hmm. like you got to include like they have the BBC streaming have Shudder.
Yeah. Too.
So you have all this properties and all these, you know, original shows that you can do. They just are starting to do Anne Rice, like an interview with the Vampire series. So mm-hmm. there's a whole line of books with a fan base that you could make comic adaptations for.
Yeah.
There's like, you know, there's a series that looked interesting called Dark Winds. It's like a Western kind of noir. It reminded me of Scalp just by the reading the premise of it. Mm-hmm. That could be an interesting book. So they have, or, you know, like I said, they have the Creepshow series on Shudder. They can bring that as a comic book.
I think they have a book already. I read that they have two titles under the AMC Network's publishing arm already.
Yeah, they have it looks like a coffee table style book, but there was a comic released, I think, through Image that was a creep show.
Yeah, yeah, that came Halloween. Out this year.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So they could do maybe like a quarterly type of thing, and that can be like a, you know, scripts for, you know, TV or movies or what have you. But like I said, there's, you know, original series, and like I said, they have a lot. They even have like an anime division, Sentai. Like I think they just sell like Blu-rays, DVDs, and things like that. But they have even access to Asian things, Japanese, you know, manga. They can do like manga, or like even do like a Shonen Jump. You know, if they want to do like a big thing of like a sampler of like, oh, you like this? Well, we have the DVD. You know, it's all about selling this other stuff. So.
Good point.
So they got a lot of more stuff than I realized under the AMC umbrella.
And I mean, look, if this Rolodex that we're joking about is as, you know, half as thick as we think it is, some interesting things could definitely come out of it. I wouldn't be opposed to a Breaking Bad comic book or a Better Call Saul kind of comic book. In the same vein as like Chicken Devil that came out through what was the name of that publisher?
That was Aftershock, or was that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, Chicken Devil that came out through Aftershock, like done, kind of done in that same vein, because mm-hmm. I felt like Chicken Devil was basically like kind of Breaking Bad-ish. So I think that would be cool. And if they don't get Kevin Smith to do a comic book under this publishing arm, because, you know, he's got Comic Book Men on AMC, I think they'd be dropping the ball if they don't get Kevin Smith to do something interesting.
Yeah. So. Yeah, it's they have the resources out there. I'm just kind of curious. And
as a creator, I mean, I would definitely want to be linked up with like AMC. That's a hell of a thing to have, like AMC Network.
Yeah, that would be pretty cool.
Yeah. So we'll see what comes out of that. I think the most immediate thing we could look forward to outside of the art of AMC. So outside of what they currently have for offerings, which is the art of AMC's The Walking Dead Universe Coffee Table Book, which I guess like was a big factor in them going further with this publishing arm because it was so successful.
Oh, wow.
Okay. There was also Shudder's Creepshow from Script to Scream that came out through Titan Books in partnership with Titan Books. And then Miss Fisher's First Mysteries is a new graphic novel.
Yeah, it's strange because they have a lot of their properties. Like Titan has a lot of those BBC properties, like Doctor Who.
Okay.
And they had, I think, Tank, like a lot of the British comics Titan has been publishing. They're still doing even like Blade Runner and stuff too. So I'm not sure if it's going to be like, okay, we're AMC Comics, but Image is our publisher, you know, like an established infrastructure that they don't have to like, okay, we got to, you know, set up all these, you know, offices and mm-hmm. positions, but we have these companies that we've been working with and they can be our infrastructure. We'll just put their name really small in the credits and then put the AMC logo really big.
That makes sense. Yeah, I guess we'll find out next year because it sounds like all of those series, those three new ones, the one by Kurt Hammett and who else? Who are the other two?
Oh man, I just closed.
So Sienkiewicz and who else?
Sienkiewicz, Kelly Sue DeConnick.
Yeah. So those series by Kirk Hammett, Kelly Sue DeConnick, Bill Sienkiewicz, all of them. Those series launched later next year, and they're doing like a special promo edition comic that'll debut at San Diego Comic Con next year, which I imagine will probably run for a pretty penny.
Yeah, and it's crazy because like so we just had Whatnot just jump on the, and they've been killing it. So that could be a reason. It's like AMC's and these guys like, are selling half a million
exactly.
comics.
And AMC's like, bitch, we got motherfucking Walking Dead. We about to milk that even more. Robert Kirkman's like hooked up to like some contraction. Like, please, for the love of God. Nah, you know what? Robert Kirkman's probably like, no, please, please. Yeah. Take, yeah. Give me another M in my
another
bank
bag
account.
Of money for you.
Good stuff.
Like a dollar sign drawn on it. Here you go.
All right, listeners, that is the news that we're going to highlight today. All right, we wanted to celebrate the careers of some of the most respected legends and artists in the comic book and pop culture world. And we wanted to humbly pay our respect. So once again, we want to share our condolences to the family, friends, and fans of Kevin O'Neill, Carlos Pacheco, and Kevin Conroy. Obviously, we couldn't get to all of the news and headlines that came out this week. We're only a two-man team today, all right? And we got a limit, too, a time limit, too. So if you feel like there was any news or headlines that came out that are worthy of getting a spotlight, why don't you do us the favor and tell us about it, right? Feel free to write in and let us know if there's any headlines or major news that we missed. In the meantime, let's now move on to our next segment and talk about the best new and upcoming comic books hitting a shop near you. Let's grab a fistful of comics.
You could either have a mouthful of tea or a fistful of comics.
Fistful of Comics is the part of the show dedicated to all you comic book... Fistful of Comics is a part of the show dedicated to all you comic curious newbies and loyal Wednesday warriors who are looking for good starting points and new stories to explore in the wide world of comics. And who better to help us point us in the And who better to help us point you in the right direction than the man who runs Jacksonville's premier comic shop, Ben Kingsbury, the owner of Gotham City Limit. As we always do, Ben has called in this week to give us his top 3 picks hitting comic shops and shelves in the coming months. So let's go and get a cool little music bed going, and let's see what's on the agenda today. Let's see. Boom, boom, boom. All right. All right. All right. His first pick is an otherworldly tribute book coming out through DC Comics, which will pay respect to one of the most notable architects of its distinguished competitors, Stan Lee. Here's Ben to tell you all about it.
Hello, Shortbox listeners and friends, wherever you may be listening from and however you may be listening. This is our first FOC pick of the week, and listen up carefully, because Tales from Earth 6, a celebration of Stan Lee number 1, is brought to you by DC Comics. Over 20 years ago, Stan Lee reimagined the DC universe, and to celebrate the icon's 100th birthday, dive into 10 new adventures featuring a criminal-turned-nocturnal warrior, a champion from the Brazilian Amazon, an intergalactic lawman, and more. Plus, a variant cover E will feature Stan's reimagined Sandman with art by my personal favorite, Kelly Jones. Think Batman Nightfall. Let's celebrate the man, the myth, and the legend the right way.
Hell yeah. Once again, that was called Tales from Earth 6. That'll be hitting shops December 27th. That Kelly Jones cover is super sweet. Sick. I didn't know that Stan Lee reimagined.
Oh, you didn't? You don't remember these?
I remember these. I didn't know he did a
Sandman.
A Sandman one.
Yeah, that one I didn't. I didn't read any of them, so yeah, that's cool though.
Wow, his 100th birthday.
This is cool though. That is epic. This is pretty neat.
All right, next up on Ben's list. Speaking of alternate versions of classic Marvel characters, this next book is all about the Hulk, but in a different skin tone. Take it away, Ben.
Legend Peter David returns to Joe Fixit. Who and what is Joe Fixit? Think the strongest one there is. However, gone are ripped up shorts of years past. This Hulk prefers the slick suave of a striped suit. Really, all you need to know is Hulk traded in his monster card for a mobster one instead. Oh, and Kingpin and Spidey. Hulk Smash is in there somewhere.
That's awesome. I love Mr. Fix-It.
Yeah, his choice in suits is I love the shoe game too. Like bowler shoes, yeah. Or shit like that.
Hulk in a 3-piece pinstripe suit
with the top hat too to match. Come on now.
So I remember reading with him and he was actually working as like a bouncer in a casino.
Yeah. Yeah. And the best part about this series, this Joe Fix-It series, which issue one is hitting shops January 4th. We're already talking about the new year already. So that'll be one of the first new comic books to hit shops on in 2023. Art by Yildire Senar. I'm never sure if I'm saying that name right, but his art is awesome. Kind of reminds me of Carlos Pacheco. I like the softness of it, but the realism. All right. Last but not least, Ben has decided to keep it in the Marvel universe with his next pick. This last one will put you on a hex regardless of what universe you call home.
And finally, we come to a new chapter in my favorite witch, Scarlet Witch. This might sound crazy. However, I'm not a huge fan of Wanda, per se. However, I can't get enough of her personality unleashed as the Scarlet Witch. Anyone who can humble Dr. Doom, see Darkhold, has my attention, and trust me when I say you need to check out Ivan Tao's variant cover. Well, another week has come and gone, and I'm still Ben K representing Gotham City Limit. Remember, with great power comes great responsibility, and always take it to the limit.
Hell yeah. Ben, Ed, I just pulled up that cover Ben was talking about.
Yeah.
Does this remind you of, like, Bill Sienkiewicz, Tula Latay kind of?
Yeah, little Jay Lee.
Yeah.
Corners.
It's a good looking cover. That's a good pick. Ben always picks like the best variant covers. He got a good eye for those. All right, Ed, of the three recommendations that Ben shared with us today, which one are you most interested in? Which one's going to get put on your pull list?
I guess I can't, even though I didn't read it the first time around, I love multiverse stuff. So I got to go with the Tales from Earth 6. Just because, you know, that idea and then just the people involved in it. I think bang for your buck, that's a pretty awesome title to get.
You know, I'm gonna go ahead and co-champion that with you, too. I think out of all the picks, this one definitely piques my interest because I think I might have read one or two of the Stan Lee Reimagined the DC Universe, the original series.
They're just all one-shots, I think.
Yeah, all one-shots. So short and sweet, and it sounds like this probably has all of them put together or maybe like a retelling, but 96 pages, $10 book, and you've got a full stacked lineup of creators. You got Mark Wade, Becky Cloonan, you've also got Michael Conrad, you got Lee Weeks, Jerry Ordway, Jim Chung is doing art on here, Dan Panosian, Christian Ward, Kyle Hotz. I mean, yeah, this is going to be tight. So I'm also going to go co-champion and probably pick up this Tales from Earth 6. And it'll be like the last book of this year. So that'll be a nice way to end the year and remember Stan Lee in a positive way. All right. Well, that's the list, listeners. If any of those pique your interest, make sure you hit up your comic shop. Make sure you get your pre-orders in. Make sure you get your pre-orders in now. Big shout out to Ben for always providing some top-notch reading recommendations. Remember, even if you don't live in Jax, you can still take it to the limit by shopping the Gotham City Limit online store for comics and exclusive shop variants. There is a link in this episode's show notes if you're interested in checking it out. Now, next up, we got some emails and fan letters to get to before sharing our favorite entertainment options with you. But that's going to take place after we take a quick music break, all right? I want to stretch our legs. I want to check on the disappointing Jags score against these Chiefs.
Oh, no.
So let's go ahead and play some music from our guy, Mecca the Marvelous. This is a new instrumental he sent me called Silvers, which samples the same, iconic soul group of the same name. Enjoy the music, and I promise we'll be right back.